Welcome, everybody. This is our second Google Summer of Code presentation and our first ever Lightning Talks. Today, our 8 GSoC students will be presenting their work in the form of a Lightning Talk. Each student will get around 5 minutes to present their project, followed by a Q&A at the end of the meeting. We will be using slido.com for Q&A, and you can go to slido.com and enter A848 as the participant code to get to the questions page. During the meeting, please feel free to post your questions there. All the questions will appear on the screen at the end of the meeting, which can then be answered by the students. This video will also be recorded and would be available offline too. So without further ado, let's start with our first presentation by Ashish.
Hello, everyone. I'm Ashish Gaba, and I'm currently pursuing my BTech in computer science from IIIT Hyderabad. And I've just completed my second year. Project for GSoC, which I've been selected, is improve the image loading pipeline. So the goals of the project aim at implement the caching and preloading for the images. This functionality already exists for the audio, and I was supposed to extend it to the images too, and adding a loading indicator in case the image is currently loading, and a try again button if the request for the images fail. The main part of the project involves migrating the images from the App Engine data store, which the Oppia currently uses, to the Google Cloud Storage, so which is similar to what we have for the audio files. So the progress that has been so far is that the images are being preloaded and cached, and a loading indicator is displayed if the images are currently loading, and a try again button if they fail to load. So next slide, please.
All right, there seems to be some problem with the slides. Just let me fix that for a minute. All right. Just let me check. Sean, can you see the screen now? All right. Let me also just pin myself. All right, Ashish, sorry for the interrupt. Can you please continue?
Yeah, sure. Can you please take it to the third slide with the images?
Yeah, sure. All right, I think it's still... there is still some problem.
Yeah, it's there.
Guys, can you see the screen now?
Yeah, it's
okay. All right.
Yeah, so I'll continue with the presentation. So as you can see, there is a loading indicator being displayed in the right image with the title loading indicator. And if the image is not available in the cache of the assets backend API service and the image is currently loading. So we display this kind of loading indicator, and the size of the image that is to be shown is retrieved, and a similar size of div is created, and a loading indicator corresponding to that size of the image is shown. And if the request for the image experiences some error, we display a try again button so that we only request for the image that has failed to load and not the entire page. So next slide, please.
Yes, Ashish, you are on the next slide.
Yeah. So yeah, it's been over 1.5 months that I'm doing this project, and honestly, doing this project has improved my technical implementation a lot. I used to write a lot of lines of code, and now I just know a functionality or a particular function that could be used instead of that line. And I've learned to work according to timelines as well as with the team. And it's always been great working with Oppia. And so far, whenever I create a PR, I just get to learn new things that make my implementation and overall confidence a lot better. And I hope I get to know a lot more with the upcoming part of the project that remains. Thank you. This was the presentation for my project, improving the image loading pipeline.
Thanks a lot, Ashish. That was awesome. So Akshay, please take over.
Yeah. So, hey guys, I'm Akshay Anand. I'm pursuing BTech Electrical Engineering in IIT Madras right now. So the project that I was doing was the Add Functionality for Skills project. Okay, next slide. So, so initially when I started, my project was just to add another skills construct to replace the existing refresher exploration construct for exploration. But through team discussions and reviews, we came to realize that a better way would be to introduce three new constructs called topics, stories, and skills, and they all will work in tandem to streamline the learner experience. Next slide. So this is some example of how it will work. So currently, the only way to have multiple explorations at a single location is to have it in a collection. But what if multiple collections teach the same topic? In that case, the learner has to manually search through the collections and find them. So what we do is have all of those collections in a single page called the topic page, which you can see on the left side. And collections are now renamed as stories. So they're called stories because they are a chain of explorations which all follow a particular storyline. And then another change from stories, from collections to stories, is that stories will also implement the skills construct, which is as follows. A skill would be a card with a card which explains the concept of the skill and some questions related to that. So before any exploration in the story starts, the skill would be the questions related to the prerequisite skills for that exploration will be displayed, so that we can determine whether the learner has enough knowledge to start the collection. And another way that skills would be used in the topic page as a whole is with the mastery skills section, which is shown there. So here, for example, if a learner who has completed the stories just want to revise the skill concept taught in the topic again, currently there's no way. So what this does is the learner can just select the skills that he or she wants to practice, and the questions related to that would be displayed. So the learner doesn't need to go through the entire storyline just to practice the concepts that he or she desires. So that's another major advantage. And as I told before, the skills also replace the existing refresher exploration. This makes the job of an editor, the creator, much more simpler. Because currently, if a learner is stuck in an exploration state, the only way to make the learner understand that is to create another fully fledged exploration that explains just the single concept that state requires. But that's not the case actually. So here we have a global skills construct. So these skills could be common across explorations. So what the creator has to do is just link that skill to a state. That's it. No need to create an additional exploration. And then if the learner is taking too long in a state, that concept card and questions related to that skill would just pop up, and the learner can browse through the concept, practice that questions, and then continue through the exploration. So thus, this eases the work for both the learner and the creator. Next slide. Anmol, next slide. Yeah, so progress. As far as progress, we have almost completed the editor page for topics, stories, and skills. And what you saw before was a mock of the topic page, or the learner view of a topic page. So like that, we have been designing the stories and skills page, and that will be completed in the near future. Next slide. So what I have learned is that, as I told before, this changed from a solo project that I was doing to a team project. So following a team timeline was something that was a major challenge, because in a team timeline, you need to plan ahead. What you're doing does not block anyone else or is being blocked by anyone. So that was one of the major challenges. And through this one and a half month of code reviews and pull requests and all, I'm confident that my ability to write clean and effective code has increased. And also through implementing new editors from scratch, my ability to think in terms of an end user, of how an end user would use the application, has also improved. So thank you. That was my project, Add Functionality for Skill.
Thank you, Akshay. That was really insightful. Thanks a lot. So moving on, Apoorv.
Good day, everyone. I'm Apoorv Bajaj, a second year undergraduate from BITS Pilani, India, pursuing a degree in computer science. I remember working on my first PR hashtag 4283 in late December last year. From that point, the journey has been a wonderful one. I love the community the organization offers. I have now been a part of the Oppia organization for almost 6 months and have been looking after the development workflow, which is my GSoC project. Next slide, please. The problem I'm tackling, style issues. There are basically three prime problems which I'm tackling. One of them is style issues. So reviewers should focus on the logic and not on stylistic issues. A number of developers, including me, tend to make stylistic errors as they code. This delays the merging of the PRs into the code base. Number two, maintainers have to repeat the same process of ensuring that PRs are moving forward. This process includes ensuring that all PRs are moving forward and hoping with the contributor. Stack PRs remain open and tend to become stale. They also have to take care that the builds pass and new contributors are ready. Repeat this process on each job. Number three, flaky end-to-end tests can block incoming PR and can severely affect the workflow. This diverts the attention of the maintainer from code review to rerunning tests until they pass. Next slide, please. My project aims at the following 3 points. Number one, automating style checks. Style checks are being automated so that the reviewers can focus on the logic and not on stylistic issues. In some cases, reviewers focus on the style during the first pass and ensure that it is readable. I want to automate this process. Number two, Oppia bot. At the moment, all processes like CL leggings, managing status, notifying the
contributor. Apoorv, sorry to interrupt you. Could you speak a little closer to the mic? I guess people are not really able to hear you out loudly. So.
Sure. Am I audible?
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, I hope it's audible to the people watching the stream. All right, please continue. Sorry.
At the moment, the three processes, CLA checking, managing stale PRs, and notifying contributors about merge conflicts are done by the maintainer on duty. The Oppia bot will automate all of these so that the PRs keep on moving smoothly. Catching more errors by improving the tests. This is to be achieved by thorough and non-flaky E2E tests and extending them for more type of browsers, desktop and mobile. These three objectives model. make up 3 milestones of my GPL. I'm done with this one. I'm on milestone. Next, please. Anmol, next slide, please.
I think we lost you there a bit. All right, please continue. Sorry.
So here you can see the Oppia bot in action, specifically the merge config. For the merge config, the Oppia bot puts a label and pings the author of the pull request, notifying the author regarding the merge config. Next slide, please. So the bot checks all the open pull requests, sorting in the system from time to time on a scheduled basis. Next slide, please. One more, can you please change the slide?
Yeah, yeah, we are on the next slide, I guess. It'll take some time to update. Yeah.
So,
can you see the next slide?
My learning so far, I have grasped a great understanding of the intake mechanisms. At Oppia, we maintain the code base in perfection. Therefore, we prefer to have a number of custom checks. And in this process, I picked up a number of linting mechanisms. I've delved deeper into the code base and got to know about the Oppia stack. I picked up Node.js, deployed on Heroku and GitHub APIs while working on Milestone 2. Thank you. This was Apoorv for improving the development workflow.
Thank you, Apoorv. I'm pretty sure it's gonna make maintainers and developers' life a lot easier going forward. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
So, moving on, I'll hand it over to Nitesh.
Hi, I'm Nitesh. I'm a second year undergraduate student at IIT Madras studying electrical engineering. My project at Oppia is the generalized view system project. Next slide, please. So, what we are planning to add is collaborative development for Oppia lessons. So we want to allow a lot of people to contribute to the Oppia lessons while also maintaining quality of the content being added for the lesson. And also we want to allow users other than admins, moderators, or creators to participate in reviews based on their previous contributions. This way we can have a lot of the community both contributing and reviewing the contributions being sent into Oppia. Also, we plan to add a scoring system for the users so that we can maintain quality of reviews and so that we do not have people making suggestions and then accepting suggestions that are not very great. So there are a lot of possible use cases for our system. So current use case, which is already present in the code base, is suggesting edits to exploration content, which has already been implemented, and we are migrating that to a new system. Other use cases include suggesting questions to a topic, suggesting edits to skill content or topic content, and many more such use cases. Next slide, please. So this is a general user flow for a person creating a suggestion. So first a user creates a suggestion, then a reviewer is assigned to review the suggestion, and the reviewer, if he is happy with the suggestion, he approves the change and the change is saved in the lesson. If not, he requests changes and then the author makes changes. So this goes on like a standard GitHub code review cycle. So until the reviewer approves the change and then it's saved in the lesson. Next slide, please. So our progress so far, we have completed the backend infrastructure for adding new suggestions, added new spaces and conditions. We have also linked
All right.
Backend, and we have written a migration job to convert existing suggestions to the new system. We have also worked on the backend models for user scoring. So what we plan to implement is emailing functionality so that people are notified when they're assigned to review, and also we are planning to collaborate with the new structures team, Akshay's project, to add suggestions to for adding questions to a topic. So it will be completed as part of milestone 3 of my project. Next slide, please. So for me, the most difficult part was planning the project, as it had to be a very generalized system. So we had to, every time we develop a new idea, we had to validate it across a lot of different use cases. And we had to make sure the model is viable in all these cases. So in that process, my technical design skills have improved a lot. And I think I have a better developer intuition as a whole. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Nitesh. Moving on to Nitesh.
I am. Thank you, Anmol. Hi, everyone. I'm Nitesh, pursuing Computer Science and Engineering from Indian Institute of Technology, India. This January, I began working with Oppia, and it has been an absolute learning curve. Next slide, please. This summer, I'm up with the project Rich Text Editor Upgrade. Its aim is to replace the current RT, which is Text Angular, to CK Editor. The foremost question that strikes the mind is why the shift is needed. The rich text components, such as inserting mathematical formula, adding a link, including a collapsible block, etc., are displayed vaguely in the preview mode of editor. They all are put to view merely as an image. To explain this better, I'll mention a small example. Suppose when a link is inserted in the editor, we expect a text to pop up, which would render the particular link. But in Text Angular, it appears as an image in the preview. Same issue percolates down to the other major components. Though the transformation shall be for the better, but it has its share of cons. This conversion of existing content into a format compatible with CK editor is certainly a time-consuming process. Oppia uses quite a few editors in the past, and hence there is a need to change the entire content which was generated when these editors were used. Presently, I have successfully been able to transform the complete bulk into a Text Angular compatible format. This was definitely an elusive assignment, as Oppia utilized quite a few editors. So what I did is, I wrote a migration script and a validation script. As the name suggests, the former one migrates an invalid form to a desired form, and the later script validates whether the content is in Text Angular format or not. After running the migration script on the server data, I confirmed that the content after migration passes the validation. If it does not, then I printed that string in the output and then checked for the non-working conditions manually. I repetitively updated the migration script till there was no output. Apart from this, I also ensured that the content pre and post migration remained the same visually. This was important. Next aim under this project is the integration of CK editor. I'm currently busy with this part of my project, and then my eventual endeavor would be to shift the whole content from the Text Angular to the CK editor. Perhaps it would be relatively easier task to be done, as now the complete content shall be in one fixed form. Next slide, please. Okay. The screenshots to here elaborate all the above mentioned problems and the solutions as follows. The first example is an example of collapsible block. In Text Angular, the block is not visible. It's just an unclear picture, but it shows up perfectly in CK editor, as my first mock shows here. The second case is of inserting link. As you can see, again, there is an image of the link, but not the text itself. There is no such problem, though, with the CK editor. The last instance is also on the similar lines. Next slide, please. Okay. I would love to share the positives which I gained from this project. Time management is one of them. Honestly, I messed up totally in the early days, which forced me to turn into a sleepless being. In the second phase, I have handled it much better and stand in a great position. Ask to the point out. It's indeed very much significant for non-directional doubts like why the Travis build is failing, etc. This question displays no particular sense. questions put to perfect point, we list all the explorations, what we did to solve this. Then thanks to my mentors that I learned extremely necessary lessons, the migration of huge content and strengthening clean, committed codes, clean and committed codes. And last but not the least, the superior most feather that I put to my cap is the lesson regarding how the whole community works and how one can convey your knowledge among a group of experts. Yeah, thank you one and all.
Thank you, thanks a lot. So I would just remind, I would just like to remind all the folks, whoever has joined us a little late, that we are taking questions on slido.com, that is slido.com. And you can go to the questions page using the participant code, that is A for Apple, 848. So it's A848. And you can post all your questions there. So moving on ahead, Pranav, please go ahead.
Hi, everyone. I'm Pranav, a computer science undergrad from India. I've been a part of Oppia for over a year now. In my time here, I've been a part of the answer classification project, following which I took up leadership of the analytics for creators project. My current project will be the latest addition to the statistics tab. This will be the learner playthroughs and issues visualization. I believe that this should be a huge leap forward in terms of providing useful analytical data for creators. Now, issues. That's a word that's going to be thrown around quite a lot this presentation. An interesting question. We provide the creator with data on the statistics tab, which is primarily composed of numbers and representative graphs. But do we ever tell them what the issue is? Do we provide them with an idea of why these issues occur? The motivation for this project basically stemmed from this question. We aim to analyze the learner sessions for issues and resurface these issues to the creator so that lessons can be improved seamlessly. Progress on this project has been fast-paced and well ahead of schedule. All of the backend framework required for recording and retrieving these issues and all the associated playthroughs have been implemented. The front-end system to analyze all learner sessions and identify potential issues is also completed and just got merged recently. There has also been reasonable progress on implementing design mocks, which is a part of the final milestone. Can we move to the next slide, please? Okay, this will be a quick overview of what I'm building. Next slide, please. So this will be the general overview of how the issues are going to be represented as. The left tab will be the list of all the issues that are currently out, and you have an issue header which tells you what the issue is. And inside the main window, we have a general resolution strategy. So this could be used to resolve this particular issue, and the state, when you click the state link, it actually redirects you to the particular state so that creators can address it pretty easily. Now, we are in the first playthrough. So when you're seeing the first playthrough, first, what comes to your mind is there's some highlighted stuff, and then there are a couple of numbers. So the first learner action is basically that it tells you that since the issue is something that says that there are multiple incorrect answers, this is the table tabulating all the incorrect answers and the feedback that the learner received. And then the final action says that the learner quit the exploration. The reason it is highlighted is because these are the most important parts of the playthrough where the learner actually had some issues and then quit. But when you click the arrow mark now, you can see what the rest of the playthrough looks like. Next slide, please. So after clicking the arrow mark, you are able to extend to see the remaining parts of the playthrough if you want to. This is very similar to how you can see GitHub code that is not actually modified in a particular pull request, but you can extend and see the remaining parts. That was the motivation behind this idea. Next slide, please, Amol. My learnings were basically, I reinforced my skills in technical design, implementation, and learned a lot about UI UX design. Technical implementation has been like a major learning curve for me ever since the stats team project. And here I could say that even though I have a long way to go, I could see improvement. And in general, with intensive code reviews that stressed a lot on general coding practices, I could say that my programming skills have improved over the course of this project, definitely. And a final request, the template that I showed in the presentation is actually a website and can be viewed at the link that's shown. And I'll put that link out there on the YouTube comments too. Everybody's free to take a look and email me any suggestions. And we are constantly looking for creator feedback too. Thanks a lot. This is Pranav again for the visualization project for issues.
Thanks a lot, Pranav. Moving on ahead. Sandeep.
Hi, I am Sandeep, and I have been contributing to Oppia from last 1 year. I had a great experience, and I've learned a lot of stuff while going through it. In March, I participated as a volunteer for Oppia's Delhi RCT, and I helped the organization in translating lessons. At that time, audio translation was an experiment to see how it affects the students' learning curve. And we found that this experiment was working well. And lots of students were engaged with audio translations. And this helped us to make Delhi RCT to be a success. After the completion of Delhi RCT, I wanted to participate in GSoC program. And at the same time, I wanted to modify the Oppia platform. As such, it helps audio translators to do their job easily and smoothly. So now I had an amazing project going on my mind, and GSoC was on the way. So I was ready for it. Slide change. So let's talk about the goal of the project. So currently we have different roles for an exploration, ranging from owner, editor, to playtester. And I wanted to have a translator role for an exploration. So next, so if we have a translator role for an exploration, then an exploration owner can assign a translator for their exploration. Now, the main motto of this role assignment was to allowing translator of an exploration to have right access to audio assets of an exploration. That is, they can only do audio related stuff like recording, uploading, and deleting audio translations. I have to make Oppia compatible for audio translation work, and I have created a mock design for this. Slide change. This mock was created with the help of a survey which I took before writing my proposal, and I did the survey with the volunteers who have participated as an audio translation in Delhi RCT. And thanks to all of them, they helped me a lot designing this mock. So the first part is used for checking the progress of audio translations, how much work is being done for translation work is being done. And in that same section, we can choose the language in which we want to do translation. The second part shows the graph, which will indicate the status of each state. And the third part will be the textual data, which a translator have to translate using the fourth section, that is the audio translation bar, where they can do recording stuff. Slide change. Yeah. So almost half of the work has been done. And I've learned a lot of things through this. Especially I've learned, the importance of writing a good project, like documentation of a project documentation is really important. And that helped me a lot in doing the entire implementation. And I realized that data structure in refactoring a project according to the requirement is a great skills to learn for a developer. And each and every project we know have many risks and lots of things. I learned about risk management, how to go through those risks and how to complete our project and all. And last but not the least, I learned about the importance of open source community. And I'm very thankful to Oppia. Thanks, that's it. I'm Sandeep, and I have worked for
Oppia and Translation Dashboard. Yeah, thanks, Sandeep. So lesson translation has always been a tedious task for our translators, and I'm sure this will really make their life easier. So thanks a lot. Moving on ahead, Vibhor. Hello, Vibhor, can you hear us?
Oh, sorry, my mic was muted.
All right.
Thanks,
no problem. Please go ahead.
Hi, I'm Vibhor, a computer science second year undergraduate student from India. I'm part of this wonderful community, Oppia, for over 10 months now. My GSoC project is New Interactions project, which aims at implementing two new interactions, that is number with units and drag and drop sorting interaction. Anmol, next slide, please. Thanks. So as I have told you, these two new interactions will help the learners in learning things more effectively. Particularly, number with units interaction will give better understanding of the units, such as SI units, non-SI, and currency units. Right now, we have the scope of validating numeric input and fraction input, but there was no way to validate number with units also. So my second interaction that I have to implement is drag and drop sorting interaction. that will give better understanding of sorting the things with the help of easy drag and drop sorting interface. So now the learners can be able to grasp difficult concepts more easily by actually dragging and dropping this stuff and sorting them. And more, next slide, please. Next slide, please. Oh, yeah. So here are the mockups for number with units interaction. The first two mockups on the left hand side shows the validation of the unit given by the learners before answer submission. It validates invalid format for writing values and units. Technically, most of the unit validation is possible via math.js library that actually checks for the correctness and syntax for writing these units. So the first mockup on the left hand side validates for the correctness of the unit. It shows that the unit SE is not a valid unit, while the second one does the syntax check. Means in order to add the dimensionality to the units, we must do that caret sign must be followed by a floating point number. In addition, the supplemental help table for writing the units is also included so that the learner can refer if he or she is stuck regarding the syntax of these units. So the two mockups on the right-hand side denotes the verification of the answer submitted by the learner. Here, suppose that the lesson creator says 2 kilometers as the correct answer to the question. So the first mockup shows that after the learner has submitted 2 kilometers as one of the answer, after hitting submit button, he will obviously get correct answer because of the equality check of these of both these answers. While in the second mockup, real magic happens. Here, even though the learner submits 2000 meters or any equivalent, for example, answer in centimeter, millimeter, or any other non-SI unit, he will be also getting the correct answer feedback as it's being validated. So it is possible because of equivalency check of the units. So now regarding the progress of this interaction, it is almost ready to be released in the upcoming July release. Only currency units are remaining to be implemented that I am planning to do in milestone 3. Anmol, next slide, please. So here are the mockups for the drag and drop sorting interaction. The learner can sort the things by dragging and dropping the tiles from top to bottom. In the first left mockup, the overlapping tiles denote that they can occupy the same position. It can be the case when suppose two fractions 2 by 3 and 4 by 6 are equivalent, and so they have to occupy the same position while we do sorting of these fractions. So this case handles this scenario very efficiently. It also supports automatic scrolling stuff, as in the mockup 2, when the tile is at the topmost or at the bottommost position, there will be automatic scrolling so that the learner can reach at the desired location even when he or she is dragging or holding the tile. So else it will be very difficult to do both the things simultaneously. While the third and fourth mockup shows that guides the learner where will the tile actually be after it will be dropped. The independent placeholder slightly at left side denotes that the tile occupying the independent position, while the fourth one shows that it will be overlapping with the node one. And one of the major challenges was to implement this UI only. So regarding the progress of this interaction, most of the part has been done, while a few PRs are left for implementation and for debugging stuff too. And then I have to implement few rules for answer verification. Anmol, next slide, please. As we all know, learning makes the man perfect. So it's very important to learn while doing things. So my current GSoC period is also going on smoothly, and I'm learning a lot of stuff in this period. The most important thing I'm learning is project planning, which I think is the most important part for the successful completion of any project. It includes making mockups, making prior technical designs, taking several decisions, and setting up timelines. It also brushed up my software development skills and taught to consider all the edge cases and loopholes in the project priorly. I also delved deeper into the code base and learned to debug the code, which is also very important skills. So last but not the least, I want to conclude that it is wonderful and great learning experience of working with amazing people in the community. Thank you guys and have a nice day.
Thank you, Vibhor. Thank you, Vibhor. I think project planning has been one thing which was common to all the learnings from our students, and I feel that it is really something that differentiates a successful project from an unsuccessful project. So, going on further, so that was our last slide, and now we will get to the questions. So just to remind you, you can post your questions on slido.com. You can use the participant code A848 and and you can post your questions on the questions page over there. So, and also you can upvote the questions, and we will take in the most upvoted questions first, followed by the others. So let's go to the questions now. All right, so this is how we're gonna take up the questions. Since we have around 8 students, the generic questions will not be taken up by all the students. Instead, we will go in an order where one question will be taken up by first 3 people and the next question will be taken up by the other 3 people. I will assign it as and when we take the questions. So the first question is coming here from Sean. All right, the most upvoted question now is coming in from Anonymous, and it's about, is there any change in ownership for collection editor? Since there's topic now having practice and story separately, does that affect ownership? All right.
Yeah. So yeah, can I start?
Yeah.
Yeah. So as I told, for now, collections and topics are separate entities. I mean, stories. Did you mean story? Because we would be replacing collection with stories. We haven't yet thought about how we'll change the roles that a current collection editor has. For example, if you are changing that collection to a story, the person who created that collection, what happens to him is not yet decided. But there would be a common topic manager for a topic. Admins can obviously can manage everything, and the admin can assign a person to be a topic manager for a topic. And so these skills can be created by any user, just like exploration, and they can be given to a topic. They can be asked to link to a topic, and these topic managers or admins can then approve of this, whether they want those skills in a topic or not. Similarly, but that's for skills, but stories and topics for now, we are just restricting to admins and topic managers, which can be expanded to future, to the general public in the future, so that crowdsourcing would be a better way. So we'll add another role, have people who have been contributing to Oppia for a long time to have ability to publish stories also. So currently only topic managers and admins can publish a topic or a story, but anyone can create a skill and ask them to be linked to a topic. Now, was that the question? I think that was it.
Yeah, I think that clears it up. Thanks a lot. So moving on ahead, we have a generic question from Sean. What advice would you give to future Oppia GSoC students? That's a golden question. So what we'll do is we'll go in around and we'll start with Akshay. And Akshay, Apoorv, Ashish, and I guess the next person can be Nitesh, if you can take that up. So yeah, Nitesh, Ashish, Akshay, Apoorv, Nitesh, can you please go ahead and take the first question, starting from Akshay?
Okay, so the main advice I would give is just to become familiarized with the Oppia code base way before GSoC itself. Because GSoC applications, I had started contributing to Oppia like 3 or 4 months before GSoC, because Oppia has a really large code base. So if you have to be familiar with quite a bit of a code of the code base to have a good idea to write a proposal. So my main suggestion would be to start off with contributing to Oppia, start off with small issues, small PRs, and then build on top of that. And so, yeah, so basically get familiar with the code base like 3 to 4 months before, and then have a good relationship with the mentors, with everyone in the Oppia community. And so that will clearly help and very much help.
All right, thanks, Akshay. Ashish, what do you think? Hello, Ashish, can you hear me? All right, looks like Ashish is not able to hear us.
Sorry, my mic was at mute. I just forgot to unmute it.
No problem. please continue.
Yeah. So I agree completely with him. I mean, knowing the code base beforehand helps you a lot because you get to know the various part, I mean, differently, the back end and the front end. And before the GSoC projects arrive, we have a lot of options if we know more of the code base, as in, you know, the different directories and the, what part counts for what particular feature and all, because that helps you thinking about what, even if you have to create a new feature, you should know where it should be implemented and what all things need to be changed. And getting the knowledge of the code base beforehand is completely helpful. In my case too, I started contributing to Oppia around October 2017, and I didn't have much idea about Angular, JS, but with the ongoing time and, you know, the solving the minor issues, I remember the first issue which I solved was the CSS one. So it's not that you can't achieve anything. You just have to start from the beginning, and the mentors and the community we have here in Oppia is very, very helpful. That helped me from going from that minor CSS issue to the project which I'm doing today. So, I mean, you should have just the focus and, you know, ability to learn, and all of the people in the community of Oppia will be there to help you. Thank you.
Yeah, that's really very helpful, Ashish. Moving on, Apoor, what would your advice be?
So I agree with this. I also suggest to the participants or the students to research well into the project which they are picking up, and put everything down in their proposal. It helps putting everything in place in your proposal while you are implementing. Also, I'd suggest them to be an active part of the community. They'll get to learn a lot while simultaneously focusing on the project. So that would be my advice for them.
All right. So Apoor, when we say like putting everything down in the project, so would it be bad if our proposal is really too long? I mean, vendors really wouldn't have too much time on their hands if they have to go through like 10 proposals. And if you really try to make the proposal a bit too long and add in some unnecessary details, do you think that might not help?
My proposal was itself of 41 pages, I remember. So it required multiple passes, but yes, it helps me now. Like, I just put to the proposal, like, this has to be done here, this has to be done here. So a lengthy proposal helps you definitely in the long run.
As long as the points that you are making are not vague and are up to the mark, I guess. Yes. It's really helpful in that case.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Okay. All right. Thanks a lot, Apoor. Moving on. Nitesh, do you have anything to add to it?
I think just one extra point would be to actually think about your project and think about how end users would use it so that you can design a good system. That's a very important step, I feel, because in the end, if you're built something that's not very usable, then it wouldn't be worth it.
Yeah, that's really very true. I mean, you have to always consider the end user, and it's because it's for him or her. Correct. That you're making the system, and not for yourself. So you always have to think from a customer perspective, or sorry, the user perspective. So
Anmol, I've one more suggestion. That actually finding your interest is the most important task, I think. Means for any for successful GSoC or for any successful project, the finding your interest is most important task. In my case, it was the same. I just liked Oppia because I did lesson translation, that I found it very helpful. So yeah, I think finding your interest is most important.
Right, Sandeep. That's really true. That's really true. I mean, you have gotta like what you're gonna do, because you'll be doing that for the next 3 months. So that's really important. Thanks a lot. So moving on ahead, we'll take the next question. Is there anything differently for your project? And we will start with Nitesh. Do you think there is anything you would like to do differently?
Yeah, definitely time management for my project. In the first phase of my project, I really messed up with time. I think I wasted some of the times in the first 10 to 15 days of the phase one, which could be really productive. And consequently, then I have to spend some of the sleepless nights to complete my task. So yeah, definitely time management is something that I would improve in the first phase.
All right, thanks. And that again ties back with proper planning, I guess. So once you have a good plan in place, I guess, you should do fine with time management, unless there are surprises in your project. So thanks a lot, Nitish. Yeah. Moving on, Pranav.
Yeah, so one thing I would definitely think I should have done differently was to put down technical implementations to the point and to the tiniest detail in my proposal. I can say that with experience, because even though I am well ahead of schedule in this GSoC project, I had to make multiple PRs where I had to just like change some stuff, change code in the backend, change database designs, just because I didn't plan some tiny service functions out or helper functions out, right? And one more important issue, important thing I would say is, if your milestones, one issue I faced was, I thought I could make better parallel PRs. Like, so I had a lot of stuff which I thought in my milestones, which I was supposed to do in parallel, but I did not again plan out the helper functions right. And I had some of them started getting overlapped and needed to be used. And I had to introduce a whole bunch of to-dos and then follow PRs with one after the other. So the parallel PR didn't go as smoothly as I thought it would. So that's something I would have liked to do better. That's it.
All right. Thanks, Pranav. Moving on, Sandeep, what would you do differently? Hi, Sandeep, are you on mute?
I think Sandeep's connections are gone.
All right, no problem. We'll move on to Vibhor. Vibhor, would you like to take this one up?
Okay. In my view, I didn't do much differently, but I think the major challenge that I faced was actually making UI UX design, because I was a backend guy before GSoC and I just learned AngularJS, and for the first time I made mockups. And yes, second one, as said by Pranav, was making multiple PRs. From the milestone one itself, I was making multiple PRs so that they are reviewed all at once and will not waste much of my time. And also, since my college is opening means in mid of July, so I have to now do all of the stuff, most of the stuff in milestones. So I am planning that way only. Thanks, Anmol.
Thank you, Vibhor. Now we have some very specific questions, project-specific questions. This one's for Vibhor. It says that in your slides, you show 2 kilometer raised to 1. Does the learner need to type the caret 1? Would 2 kilometer be enough?
No. 2 kilometer will actually be enough. I just showed that due to clarity. And also means it's optional whether to write that or not. And also I've added this help table also in case the learner wants to just look at the syntax of these units.
Right. I think that would be really helpful for the learner to see such a chart.
Right.
So does a chart also shows that you can use 2 kilometer instead of 2 km caret 1?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. I've also shown that you can write full kilometer 1 or that short form of kilometer like km. The chart covers all this stuff.
All right. Okay. Thanks, Vibhor. Moving on to the next question. What does improving tests entail? Are you going to implement more tests or just improve current E2E tests? What's the end goal regarding this? I think this one's for
improving end-to-end test basically focuses on increasing like spreading the test across different browsers, different mobile viewports. Like we are planning to run them on Firefox, we are planning to run them on Android, iOS, Safari. So that is basically improvement and like expanding them. And for organizing, like we had lumped some tests in a single file, so we are planning to separate them and also make it easier for developers to run like a single utility test, basically.
All right. That's really helpful. So moving on further, are all the interactions of users with exploration recorded? How does this scale when we have a lot of interaction? I guess this one's for Pranav.
Hello. Yeah. Right now all the interactions are not actually recorded. The interactions that are currently recorded are interactions that can be represented as a clean string. For instance, a lot of the text input, it'll record the multiple choice input, it'll record the number input, and it currently will not be supporting the music input and like a couple of other interactions, but that is definitely one of my future goals to personally try to get every interaction into a representable form, maybe a pop-up of sorts. That was my idea initially. So it'll be done when we have proper visualization in place for most of the interactions. So, yeah.
Okay. All right. I think that helps. Thanks, Pranav. Moving on ahead. Are the issues for learner visualization automatically created? In mockup, there was a title for issue and simple walkthrough. How is that decided and created?
So the issues for learner visualizations are actually not automatically created. It's currently limited to three issues. The three issues are early quit, which means a learner quit within a threshold. There is a multiple incorrect submissions issue, which means the learner answered more than a threshold number of times incorrectly and ended up staying in the same state and then quit. There's one more called the cyclic state transition issue, where the learner keeps going back and forth and reaching the same state again a threshold number of times and then quitting. So he's looping back and forth in the exploration and then quits. So these are the three issues we are currently recording, but the framework is set up such that whenever we want to record any more additional issues, it's pretty easily extensible. So it's always prone to future. Anybody is free to record any issues that they want, surface any issues they want to show to the creator.
Okay, so Pranav, are there any other kind of issues that we are planning to implement, or is there anything left for the future work or something which we have not implemented?
So what I would say is that most of these issues were that we found out was from discussion with Sean regarding how the the Delhi trials, random control trials went. So these were issues that Sean said we faced during the post RCT analysis. So these were the issues that we currently used. So by the time we get to the next RCT and we inform more data, I'm pretty sure we'll have a little bit of additional data to look up to in future reference. But right now, yes, this is the plan. These are the only three issues right now that will be recorded for multiple states. Yes.
Yep. Thanks, Pranav. I think these are really important issues, it will be really good if we could, you know, help the creator to understand what's wrong. And it's just great. So moving on ahead, is the audio recorded by the browser itself, or do the translators still have to upload in specific format? So this one's for Sandeep.
The audio recording stuff can be done through, you know, Oppia platform. We will have a recording bar in the translation tab through which anyone can, like a translator, can do the recording stuff and they can upload audio directly from the platform. And yeah, the audio translator stuff. No, you don't. Currently, you can upload after this completion of project, you can upload audio, but you also have a functionality to record it directly on the platform.
Okay, all right. So, Sandeep, I have a question. Do we also have some kind of functionality to upload the files in a format where they can be automatically assigned to different?
Yeah, I have been working on that part, and I'm finalizing that part is, you know, multiple uploads that will help translator to upload multiple audio files at a time. And I have been also working on that.
All right. That's a great feature. All right. Thank you, Sandeep. Moving on ahead. Can review of translation be shifted to generalized review system as well? This way, we can allow everyone to do the translation instead of translator role. So I think this one's for Nitesh.
We have all users suggest translations for explorations, though I think it would be better to have the translation role too, because eventually you'll need someone to review the translations, and translators would be pretty apt for that. So we could shift the translations to the generalized review system and allow a lot more people to contribute. But yeah, I don't think it would be instead of the translator role, it would be along with a translator role, probably.
Okay, Nitesh. So just to clarify, we do not have a plan to do that as of now in any of our milestone, right?
Yeah, the review system is extendable to include this. As of now, it's not planned.
Okay. Thank you, Nitesh. I hope that clarifies the question. So the next one's for Ashish. What was used before loading indicator? Ashish, can you hear us? I think you're on mute.
We didn't have anything before this loading indicator. The main idea behind this project was that any user can interpret the question wrong, because if the image was loading, there was no indication on the page that the image is loading, and the user might have interpreted that, you know, there is no image for that, and might have answered wrong. So that was the main purpose for this project, that the user should be the page should be informative enough so that user knows that the image is loading, and he or she has to wait for that. So there was nothing as such before.
Okay. All right. I think that makes sense. And that answers the question. Yeah. So moving on ahead, will you guys be expanding the E2E test for the new functionalities?
I think the E2E tests are written by each developer while a PR is sent for the new functionality. So they are expanded simultaneously, I guess, as and when we implement new functionality.
All right, so it'll be done we'll be playing it by ear and then adding it as and when the new features come, right?
Yes, exactly.
All right, that makes sense. All right, thanks, Apoor.
Thank you.
So
thank you, V.
Before moving on, we have a rather generic question over here. What was your most fun moment? So before taking the generic questions, we will take the specific project-specific questions. So this one's for Nitesh. Who would decide reviewers? Can anyone become reviewer based on contribution, or is it set by admin?
So our current plan is as follows. So as and when a user makes a contribution, he develops a score, and the score is maintained for each category. So you can have a score for, let's say, Hindi translations, and a separate score for math content suggestions. And users with high enough scores, meaning they have enough contributions in that category, will be able to review suggestions in that category. So anyone can become a reviewer, but admins will be given rights to extend this, so they can either revoke review rights or assign review rights for certain users as need be. I think that answers the question.
Okay. That's really helpful. Thank you, Nitesh.
Thank you.
Moving on ahead. So we have another question for you, Nitesh. Can we require a normal exploration to be reviewed before publishing? I think it might help maintain the quality of explorations.
So this is an interesting question. So I think
it's okay. If you need some time to think over it, we can come back to it later.
Yeah, I'll answer this at the end.
Sure, Nitesh. So we'll just park that aside. All right. So we'll take up the next one. Does creator have to do anything additional while working with numbers with units to work? Second error. Yeah, please go on. Yeah.
Actually, creator nothing has to do anything additional while setting the answer group for the number with units interaction. As the case in the all other interactions, he just has to decide one answer group, then select rules out of the following rules, and then for the particular input, he has to set the particular feedback. And the second error that I have shown in the mockup was by default. Means I have handled all these all these exceptions using mat.js library, and it is not at all set by the creator. It is just the validation before the answer is just submitted by the learner. I hope it.
Alright, so as far as the creator is concerned, it's a no for him.
No means he can explicitly set set the feedback for that if he desires, but this validation will be done automatically.
All right. That makes sense. So moving on to our next general question. I think this is open for everyone. So people, please feel free to go ahead and take this one up. What have the most fun moments of your GSoC project have been so far? Who would like to go first?
I'll go.
Sure, Pranav. Please take it.
Yeah, so I would say the best moment of my GSoC project so far has been the project design template, because I've like done enough backend work, and it's quite a little bit of front end Angular code, and it, like, even though it felt good to finish all of that, it didn't feel the best. But when I actually, the best part was like actually spending 3 hours to get a hexagon in CSS printed right, like that really felt pretty nice.
All right, bye. Thanks, Pranav, for sharing your fun moment. Anyone else?
I think my case is also the same. As I was the backend developer, so I really enjoyed making mockups, and also it was really challenging for me also, because I have to change the design several times. So yeah, I learned a lot and also enjoyed in this while doing this stuff.
All right, Sateem. Thanks a lot.
For me, I had a few moments like this. So I had written a lot of functions which do a lot of queries, and then in the end I wrote a function that does the same thing in 5 lines and covers all of those cases. So yeah, that was a fun thing to do.
Writing concise code.
Yeah.
All right, great. So what about others? Are we not having fun?
Yeah, it's always fun when you get your head into something and, you know, you've been working on it like for 3 to 4 hours, and then finally it works. It's the best feeling ever, I think so, for every developer, I guess. And for me, it was the case when I was able to get the dimensions of the image which I was supposed to use for the loading indicator. I mean, I was stuck at it badly, and finally I was able to implement that, and I was like, thank God it happened. And yeah, all things have been a lot of fun to implement in this project.
Yeah, even in my case, after having an entire milestone for just having the backend part, then once you start the front end, when it actually talks to the backend and displays information, it's just nice. Yeah, it was a very fun moment.
All right, guys. Thanks a lot for sharing your fun moments. So moving on, Nitesh, would you like to take up the question?
Yeah. So I think it does make sense to have a review, but it could be quite time consuming, because an exploration could be quite complicated with a lot of states and branching and answer groups. So you will need a full thorough review of the exploration and have a method to pinpoint certain parts of the exploration so that the creator knows that needs to be improved. So this as for the suggestions we are handling with the generalized review system, most of them are single point suggestions, I would say. So you have one entity being edited, and which is easier for a reviewer to review. So it's not very, I mean, it's not a time consuming review process. So I think it would be slightly complicated to think of a full exploration review at the moment with the review system we are building.
All right, Nitesh. Thanks a lot. So I guess with the current system, at going forward, would we be able to implement a system wherein we could do this? We could, you know, before publishing, there is a higher level of admin, and that particular admin could really, you know, approve the publishing of exploration. Could we do that?
I think, I mean, backend wise, it is theoretically possible, but I think designing a good UX would be the key point for this operation. Right. So,
yep, I agree.
Theoretically, yes, it's possible.
Yep. So the generalized review system can actually support that, but the UX and UI, that has to be hashed out, I guess.
Yeah.
And it would require a lot of changes, I would say.
Possibly, yeah.
Yeah. All right, Nitesh. That's really helpful. So I think that brings us to the end of Q&A session, and we do not have any more questions coming in also. So, all right. Thanks a lot, guys, for presenting. It was really great to have you and to see the progress that you have made so far. These projects are really, really important to Oppia. And we are all excited to see them being developed. And we all really hope that we get to use it. And, you know, some of them really will make us, will make our life a lot easier going ahead. If anyone has any question, please feel free to reach out to the students. We understand that it was a short presentation because we had a lot of students. We did not really want to make it a large presentation and bore you out. So if you have any follow-up questions, please feel free to reach out to the students or their mentors, and we'll be happy to help you out. So you can actually go ahead and set up a meeting with the student and mentor, or if you want, you could also reach out to me and I can help you with that. For your information, this recording will be available offline of today's meeting. So thanks a lot for joining us today. And that's the end of the presentation. Thanks a lot, guys, and bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.